In the Eastern Conference Final Game 4, we saw a totally different game than perhaps many expected. Tony Loughman, Kevin Weeks, Scott Stevens. Scott, you've said it many times. That's one of the best things about the playoffs is how different a series can be from one game to the next.
Yeah, it's adjustments. It's a game of adjustments from game to game. And I thought Coach Cooper did a nice job getting Tampa to play the right way. And Tampa did a very good job, very diligent job, getting pucks deep behind the Pittsburgh defense, making them play defense. And if you're going to stop the high-octane Pittsburgh Penguins, make them play in their zone, make them come back and stop in D-zone coverage. That's what the Tampa Bay Lightning did earlier. Early and often.
Tampa looked like Tampa when they're at their best, and that's exactly what they needed to do.
The Bolts were ready from the very start. Highlight from Amalie Arena. 2-1 the series tally. That building was buzzing. Ready. Andre Vasilevsky and the team, however, warm-up, not ideal. Tyler Johnson takes a puck to the face, Scotty.
Yeah, this happens, and guys love to shoot for that crossbar. It sounds good and looks good and feels good, but sometimes guys get hurt.
First minute of the game. Bolts buzzing. I mean, like 30 seconds in. Ryan Callahan in front. That skill, 1-0.
Low to high. Love it. This is them getting the puck below the goal line, then going out to the point to Hedman. Hedman does a nice job getting the quick wrist shot, but here's the heavy forecheck. You see Callahan, who was instrumental in this win tonight, working hard here, and then Brown gets it to the point, and look at Hedman with his great shot. Look at Callahan fight to the front and make a tip back against the green. Good job by Callahan getting on the forecheck, being physical, and then getting to the front of the net.
5 minutes gone by in the first, and Tampa still buzzing. Tyler Johnson battling back and coming in hot. Shot stopped, but what an effort.
Coming in hot indeed, and pays the price. Chris Letang gives him a little shot. He's saying, I can't really see with the cage.
Don't like the bird cage.
No, and then he goes to the aquarium. Equipment manager, my man Ray Phil, doing his thing there. No goldfish inside that one. Now he's going to have to get it cleaned. He's used to it. Now he's going back to the cage. All right, no problem. Play on.
Whatever you want, number nine, with the way you play. He's a hockey player. He was going to play in this game. 6.5 to go in the first. Pens threatening. Andre Vasilevsky, Weeksy, sprawling out.
Unreal save by Vasilevsky. Push, takeaway angle, and then extend. Great athleticism by Vasilevsky.
Preserving the one goal lead. Significant because here come the Bolts. Drop pass. Andre Schuster, 2-0.
Look at Schuster getting in the play, but nice job by Tampa Bay stalling the engine, waiting for the cavalry to come. And here comes Schuster late. And look at Kucherov, the no-look pass. And Schuster makes no mistake, putting that one past Matt Murray. Nice execution by the Bolts.
And things were not going well for the Pens. Even friendly fire. Brian Dumoulin runs his goalie.
That's
Matt Murray.
That's your tender. Come on. That's your tender. All right, we know his accident.
20 minutes in, Tyler Johnson. Aquarium.
Yes.
Pittsburgh power play. 3 minutes gone by in the second. Phil Kessel coming in and denied.
How about great power move by Kessel. Great extension. Nice poke check by Vasilevsky. I love it by the big goaltender.
Phil Kessel not happy. Penguins leading scorer, not bashful.
He should have a mic on.
Yeah, I'd love
to
hear that.
The big hit. Ryan Callahan colliding with Trevor Daly. Daly left the arena after this game on crutches. Alarming to say the least.
Looks like he's in pain there, Tony.
No doubt. And we know how important he is. Things got very heated in the second period. Watch what happens here. Chris Letang beside himself. Ill will on the ice. Resulting 4-minute power play. Tampa Bay trying to take advantage, but it's a shorthanded chance. Here comes Eric Fair. Great back check by Drouin to make it difficult, and Vasilevsky makes the stop.
Watch Drouin pick the stick of Fair. Excellent, and great concentration by Vasilevsky as well on that off-speed shot.
Watch what happens here. Power play down to 1 minute left. Drouin poised. Yawning net, it's 3-0.
I love how Victor Hedman takes the ice the Penguins give him. Look at the ice he takes here, then he finds a seam pass to Drouin. Drouin tries to go to Palat, it comes back to him, puts in the open net. Well executed by the Bolts on the power play. Here's Drouin making a difference once again for the Tampa Bay Lightning.
His third goal of the series made it 3-0. Just over 2 minutes left. Kucherov firing a pass towards the front of the net, off of Johnson and in. It's a 4-goal Bolt lead.
You got to get there if you want to score. Nice play by Kucherov. Left-hand shot to right-hand shot. This goes off the shin pad of Tyler Johnson, but if he wasn't in position, that wouldn't have happened. You got to get there.
Goalie switch, Marc-Andre Fleury in. First game since March 31st. He had the concussion that kept him out, and Matt Murray's been so good, Flower has remained on the bench. Phil Kessel, amazing shot, Scotty.
Absolutely, he shoots it the best in stride. Look at Vasilevskiy, how far he is out there. And here comes Kessel, jumps on the ice, gets a pass, and look at this shot in stride. Puts it in a perfect spot to beat Vasilevskiy.
He made that look so easy, his eighth goal of the postseason. 4-1 the score. Nemestikov, threatening, but Fleury was there. Under 13 to go, Kucherov, Flower again. Seven even strength shots faced, seven stops made by 29. Here comes Evgeny Malkin off the schneid after an eight-game goal drought. 71's on the board, and we got a two-goal game.
Great job by Kunitz. Look at Kunitz open up the ice for Malkin, taking out Kuku right here, letting Malkin get to middle ice and making the great shot, beating Vasilevskiy.
So, Pittsburgh on a power play, under seven to go. They couldn't make it a one-goal game, could they? Yes, they could.
No
Chris
way.
Kunitz.
Come on. Pittsburgh making a late charge of it. Still some time. What a pass. Shot pass by Sheary. Unselfish play. Shoot to create a goal, and he does just that.
Final minute of action. Extra attacker on, and the Penguins taking aim. Now to the final 7 seconds. Kunitz and Pittsburgh looking to tie. Vasilevskiy and the Bolts hang on. 4-3. In game four, we've got a series. It's 2-2. Best of three for the Prince of Wales Trophy. Could it be any better? Andre Palat and the Bolts victorious. His post-game reaction here.
Yeah, I think it's all about our energy and our speed. You know, I saw a big difference in those two periods. You know, we were fast. We were forechecking hard then, and it was good.
I think, you know, compared to game three, we wanted to have a much better effort. And I think we did that throughout the first two periods. Even in the third, you know, I think we kind of let, you know, a couple. Vasi, we needed to stand by him a little bit better than that. But other than that, we won the game, and that's the most important thing.
You know, we knew we were going to come on top on that game. I think you could see it from the bench. We weren't nervous, we weren't panicking, like you said, and we pulled through. We didn't bet. We bet, but we didn't break.
Okay, a little getting used to it again, but you know, the guys battled hard enough to make a comeback and score goals and all. So it's so disappointing to come up short.
Mike, with the fact that Marc-Andre has been the franchise goalie, that he's been through a lot of battles with these guys, would any of that, with what you saw from him tonight, play into your decision for who will start?
I haven't even really given it any thought at this point, Rob.
Plenty to think about for Lightning fans, as in, how lucky are we? Tyler Johnson and Nikita Kucherov, those are career records. Those two young guys producing at an historic rate, putting themselves alongside Richards, who of course we remember as the Conn Smythe winner in 04. René Cavalier, Marty Saint-Louis. Richards had 7 game-winning goals in their cup year.
Amazing.
Remarkable. Also amazing, Scotty, as we think about the Bolts playing back to their identity, as you said, Weeksy, that first period, Scotty, they were back, out shooting Pittsburgh 18-12 and playing right away like you thought they needed to.
Yeah, they got pucks deep. They didn't turn pucks over. They managed the puck well. They got it below the goal line, went from low to high, had some nice point shots, had traffic. Callahan was physical on the forecheck. And I think they started backing the Penguins off. Then they started using their speed game, the Kucherov driving people back, and then they're making plays. Schuster comes up from the defense and joins the rush. But just exactly how you want to play. They manage the puck, Weeksy, so well here tonight, and that's what you need to do against a Pittsburgh Penguins team. They backcheck hard, but like I said, everything the Lightning did was smart. They put pucks where they could get them, and like I said, they forechecked early and often, backed up the Pittsburgh defense, and made life very difficult for them, something they haven't done consistently in this series.
Yeah, and two really similar teams in this matchup, of course, when you look at the way they play stylistically, both speed, both skill, tons of offense, getting production. I'd say Pittsburgh probably a little bit more through all four lines, but in saying that, Tampa had to get back to playing their game. They had the start to do it. They had the approach and the game plan to do it, and more importantly, they were able to execute that. If you're the Pens, you like the way you finish. You don't like the way you started, but to be able to put up those goals and make a run of it late, that'll give them some hope going back home to console as well.
And we heard Mike Sullivan say he hadn't given it much thought. Certainly, this will give him pause when he looks over these numbers. Matt Murray, first 7 games, in the cage, in the playoffs, beautiful. 944 save percentage, GAA under 2. Last six, GAA just under 3. Save percentage, 892. One loss record of 3-3. What's your reaction?
I wasn't aware of those numbers. That's very interesting, but I don't think it's an indication of how Matt Murray's played. I think he's played very well, and I think some of it's just good offense by the Tampa Bay Lightning and maybe not attention to detail defensively by the Pittsburgh Penguins in helping Matt Murray, but it'll be interesting to see where they go. I mean, one positive on this team like Weezy is the way the Pittsburgh Penguins finished. Also, another positive is getting Marc-Andre Fleury in the net without having to start him. Getting 20 minutes under his belt is a nice thing for Mike Sullivan and Pittsburgh Penguins going forward here. We know how important everybody is in winning the Stanley Cup. It's going to be vital that they have Marc-Andre Fleury available to play, and getting him in here in the third period was an excellent option for Mike Sullivan, and we'll see where it goes from here.
Exactly. I think this affords Mike Sullivan two great options, of course, but getting Fleury in there, getting him game tested, it's been a long time since he's seen game action. One of the things for Marc-Andre Fleury is, of course, he works exceptionally hard in practice, competes. He's had a great attitude throughout this whole thing. And I think this is a great situation to be in if you're a team and if you're a coach, because you know that the youngster has been outstanding for the most part. Yes, when you look at some of those numbers, but one thing to keep in mind, Pittsburgh was doing a good job on the defensive side, and Tampa wasn't necessarily playing their game either. So all these things will be factored into the equation, but whoever goes to net for Pittsburgh, I know one thing. Everybody in the locker room is going to feel good because they know they got a chance to win. And that's the exact same thing we're seeing on the other side.
Sure.
By the way, Ben Bishop trying to heal up.
Sure.
But Vasilevskiy has been incredible.
But it's been early for Vasilevskiy. He hasn't played as many games as Matt Murray.
This is true.
Is what I want to ask you. As a young goalie, is this tough? I mean, there's a lot on his plate. I mean, he's played very well.
Yes.
But his numbers aren't as good. But maybe it's the work in front of him hasn't been exceptional as of late. And the Tampa Bay Lightning are taking to him and starting to make some plays and score some goals. But I think this is very difficult. Matt Murray's a young goalie. He's played a lot of hockey. So having Fleury there available isn't a bad thing.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's a luxury.
A luxury.
Yes.
Item. And keep in mind, too, guys, one thing that we haven't really factored into the equation here is this is Tampa, and I played in Tampa, and as beautiful as it is down there, you've got to do a lot to hydrate as well for every game, especially as a goalie. And they take those games can take their toll on you as well a little bit on the physical side, let alone emotionally as a young goalie. So, hey. Let's see where this goes in Game 5 back in Pitt.
Whoever's in goal for the Penguins, they're certainly going to be aware of 27. Jonathan Drouin, remarkable in Game 4. His goal week, see, I know you saw a lot on that sequence.
I didn't see as much as he saw because he was C-3PO out there. This guy was seeing everything.
A lot of shoulder checks.
Tons of shoulder. I might need a neck brace after this, but watch the shoulder checks. I count one. There's two. Look at him in the neutral zone, scanning. Who do I have? Okay. Who's with me? No problem. What are my options? Guys behind me, do we have a second wave? Okay, he zeroes in on Justin Schultz. Now, a nice little drop pass to Kucherov. Now, watch Jonathan Drouin. He says, all right, I'm going to go at Justin Schultz. I'm going to back him off. I'm going to engage him. Scotty, you don't like this as a D, do you?
I hate that because I can't use my stick. I can't react to Kucherov where he dropped the puck. Smart play by Drouin, not taking the long way, going through Schultz, making it very difficult, backing him off, giving Kucherov time and space now to enter the zone and set the power play up.
One-on-one, excellent play. And this is how you can make a difference without the puck as well. So Drouin does it with the puck, but without. Shoulder check. Who's coming? Where am I going? But not only that, where's the coverage? He scans, he sees four Pittsburgh Penguins there. He says, no problem. The best thing for me to do is uncheck myself and take myself away from coverage. Look at all the Pens defenders. You see four on your screen. Okay, not a problem. Drouin says, all right, I'm going to just be undercover. You guys are looking for me. You can't find me. You won't be able to find me. Rolls off the coverage, says he's going to take a different route. He's going behind the net. But before he does, he's looking to make sure. Okay, do we have puck possession? Yes, we do. Scotty, you noted that's big Victor Hedman up there.
Absolutely. And look at Palat, goes to Bonino, makes time for Hedman to get to the middle ice. He gets to the top of the circles, gets to middle ice, and is able to make that seam pass to Drouin.
You can't even see Drouin, but you can see his stick.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the right of your screen. But the Penguins seemingly still in good D-zone position. They've got four guys. The Jonathan Drouin presents his stick, as coaches will say, present your stick. Now watch Drouin come back to the middle. He faded out, now he's coming back to the middle to put himself in a better position as an option. But no Pittsburgh Penguin within this window. Not one. Not one in coverage. So Drouin not only sees. Now, if you're Justin Schultz, Scotty, for me, If I'm Justin Schultz in the spot shadow, I'm going to back off and pick up Palat.
Yep, get your body into Palat. Keep your stick free. Let Matt Murray have Drouin here.
Absolutely. So Justin Schultz says, okay, no problem. I'm going to try to prevent pass, but he doesn't seal out Palat, nor does he take his stick. Now, if I'm Matt Murray, look at Matt Murray's head. His head's clearly focused on that of Jonathan Drouin and the puck. I want that one-on-one. Why? Jonathan Drouin's a left-hand shot. Look at his stick. He's on his strong side. If he's a righty, he can cut to the middle. He can't cut to the middle as easy here. Otherwise, he's going to have to do it on his backhand. It'll be a short play. He might not be as assertive on the offensive end. So Matt Murray, for me, ideally wants to lock horns with Drouin mano-a-mano. That's not the case. Schultz backs off just for a split second. One goes off Palat. Broken play. Back to Jonathan Drouin. Intelligent play by Tampa with and without the puck. Brilliant situational reading by Jonathan Drouin, also with and without the puck. Pittsburgh, a couple of miscues end up costing there on the D side.
Scott. Yeah, for me, I would like to see Justin Schultz pick up Drouin, slide over to the other side because you had Dumoulin and your partner coming back on the left side, so you could fold over there and just get close so you have a stick's reach of Drouin to take the Hedman pass away. But like you said, once he wasn't there, he's got to stay with Palat and let Drouin go at it one-on-one with Matt Murray.
What a dandy, the way you guys broke that down. When we come we got to have them do that for the Western Conference Final. Game 4, Saturday night, San Jose at the Shark Tank against the Blues, who haven't scored in 150 minutes. Think about that. The Sharks in command, a 2-1 series lead. However, Blues coach Ken Hitchcock said, quote, the series is 2-1. You've got to win four games. This is nothing. The numbers, interesting. We have our own. Jamie Hirsch covering the series in depth. Let's check in with her in San Jose.
Well, here we are at the Sharks practice facility where the Sharks had a light workout and practice after a dominant performance in Game 3. And I can tell you from the amount of hooting and hollering going on all throughout practice, this is a group that loves to have fun, and they certainly know how to keep it loose.
It's loose but productive, I think, is probably the best way. A lot of these guys have been around each other for a long time. They enjoy each other's company. They enjoy being at the rink, and they love the game. So, you know, the battle this year has been to get them to get off the ice and save their energy a little bit, but they bought into that too. You saw Jumbo stayed out there about 2.5 minutes today. So, you know, I think they understand the value of energy. This group prepares as well as any group I've ever seen, you know, to a fault. They want to be on the ice. They want to be working. So, you know, it took a little while to find that sweet spot.
You know, we've been playing together for a while as far as me and Jumbo, and Hertz has done a great job of forechecking, holding on to pucks, and you know, he's been a big part of that. And you just have, as you play at the puck more and score a few goals, you get a little confidence, and you know, there's good communication out there. But you know, obviously on nights when we're successful, all three of us have, you know, had a good game, and you know, it's played well.
We've seen how deep this team is up front, getting all four lines rolling throughout the playoffs. But don't forget about their depth on the blue line, too.
I think it's a really fun group. I think we get along well, and a lot of communication between the eight of us. You know, and then having Boogs has been great. I think just the way he communicates with us and, you know, makes guys feel, I think it's just been good.
You know, I'm not being asked to do anything too spectacular, just make the saves I'm supposed to make, and the guys have been taking care of the rest.
Martin Jones actually did not take part in practice on the ice anyway on Friday, telling me that he's taken a lot of maintenance days over the past month or so just to keep up with the grind that is the Stanley Cup playoffs. As for the Blues, they are also opting to stay off the ice, focusing instead on resting up and being energized to come out and try to even up this series in Game 4 on Saturday.
The results for Martin Jones have been spectacular. Back-to-back shutouts in the conference finals. The last 20 years, the guys who've accomplished that, an impressive list. That Jaguar guy in 2003. Scotty, you saw him up close. The Dominator. Marty Brodeur, Michael Layton, good company for Jones to be in. There's a bit of a goalie controversy swirling on the other side of the matchup, that St. Louis Blues. After Game 3, Ken Hitchcock was asked about it.
I'm just wondering if there's a decision to be made in goal moving into the next game between Brian and Jake.
Thought I'd get away on that one. Yeah, I'm going to think about it. Got two good goalies, pretty easy choice. Can't lose on either one. But I'll kind of wait that one out and, you know, kind of sleep on it and talk to Jimmy and talk to the coaches and see what they think.
So Hitch slept on it, and this was the decision. Jake Allen will start Game 4. Interesting move. So we turn to our resident goalie, Weeksy. And Scotty, what do you make of this decision, and what does it tell you about where the Blues are?
It's a bold one. I think the St. Louis Blues right now, if you look at the way they played in this series, they haven't played their game. Make no mistake about it. I don't think that hangs on the shoulders of Brian Elliott by any stretch. And not for Brian Elliott, the St. Louis Blues aren't here. The fortunate thing for the St. Louis Blues is they've had two really good goalies all season long. Both have been outstanding during the regular season. Really impressed with Jake Allen's progression. Brian Elliott played like a man possessed down the stretch, and he's helped the St. Louis Blues to get to this point. Now, when you look at it, for me, I thought that they would have gone with Brian Elliott the rest of the way. But the coaching staff felt as though, okay, our team hasn't been anywhere near what we should be. We're not playing our style of game. So for the purpose of getting a bit of a reset, and hopefully, if you're a Blues fan, and more importantly for Ken Hitchcock, hopefully that turns the dial up for his team to come out and play at least a style of play that they've really relied upon to this point, save for this series.
Yeah, I think this is just to get the attention of the team right now. They're not playing very well. San Jose has been outstanding the last two games, playing their game, playing very smart. This isn't on Brian Elliott at all, but I think they're just looking to change the complexion of the series. And sometimes putting a different goalie in there gets the attention of the players, makes them bear down, makes them get back to playing their game. And right now, the Blues have not played their game the last two games. They played right into the hand of the San Jose Sharks. So I don't think it really matters. Both excellent boys, but like I said, it's just to change the complexion of this series right now, because right now it's a one-way series. San Jose's having their way with the Blues.
But one thing I'm going to add to that is, and having been a goalie, it's one thing to say that you're going to, because it's all about the team ultimately. But since it's all about the team, some of the other guys on the team better raise their level.
Sure.
Because there were three changes in the lineup for last game. Some of the guys in the team for the St. Louis Blues need to elevate their game right now. This can't hang on Brian Elliott's shoulders.
Yeah, along those lines, Scotty, you've made this point before. It's not just the goalie. It's easy to point at the goalie because the puck goes past him. But there was a point you wanted to make about Robbie Fabry in a sequence that wasn't his best work in Game 3.
Yeah, Robbie Fabry's been outstanding. He's a young player. He's still learning. But they're not managing the puck very well. They're not making the San Jose defense turn and defend. They're leaving the pucks at their feet. They're turning pucks over. And here it is right here. So you watch this puck goes down the ice, and here they are on the breakout. Here's Fabry. Now, I'd like to see Fabry just make a nice little area pass. Just behind the defender, you see Bollmeister coming. Put this in the area here. Then you got Stastny coming down to the right wall behind the referee. Now you can advance the puck over there and make this team play defense. If you keep the puck in front of the defense, it's an easy game. So right here, just slide back. But what does he do? Turns it over. There's Donskoy, there's Couture, and here's a 3-on-2 now, all because of not managing the puck very well. And that's a heck of a shot by Donskoy. He's a rookie on this team, but he blows it past Elliott. But that's just a place where they're not managing the puck very well. Fabry, just put the puck in behind the goal line and make that defense turn, make them play defense. They haven't done a good job of getting pucks deep. They're leaving pucks in the neutral zone for the Sharks to transition. And the Sharks are a very good transition team. They got two lines that can sting you on the transition. They got to play a 200-foot game, get the puck below the goal line, and go to work down low. You're not going to score goals in the transition. This team's back-checking too well. They're playing too cohesive right now. You got to break them up and get the puck behind the goal line, cycle some pucks, create some distractions, and get pucks to the net.
No question. Fully agree. Fully agree, Tom.
Donskoy's a rookie. I thought in the postgame comments, Hitch said that the playoffs aren't about rookies. Well, I'm a little confused on that. But let me follow up with Hurdle, who happens to be playing outstanding hockey. He had two goals in the game. I know something caught your eye on one of those goals, Scotty.
Well, Hurdle's, he's a big, strong guy. He had some injuries, but he's playing outstanding hockey, and I love his game. I mean, the one goal here, here's the goal here. Here's Parayko, the young defenseman. Now here, he goes up the middle. No problem. That happens. But now watch what he does. he goes running over to the other side, to Shattenkirk's side, to play Pavelski, when really all he has to do is stay on his own side here. If after that pass up the middle, he just stays on his own side, protects that part of the ice, this won't happen, because you have numbers here. We have four Blues against three Sharks here, and really Joe Thornton's not doing anything, but Parenko leaves his side of the ice to come over to Shattenkirk, and he compounds the problem. And this is a young defenseman. He's going to learn. I love the upside of this guy. He's a phenomenal defenseman. He's well coached, but these things happen in the playoffs. But that's just chasing the puck there. Stay on your side. There'll be no chance for Hurdle. That's the first goal of the game. It's a huge goal. Yes, it's a great goal by the Sharks. I love the way they go from defense to offense, but that's why you have to manage the puck and play more positional to win the game.
Absolutely. And not to be outdone, there's another goal that we're going to illustrate the San Jose Sharks. So not only scoring off the rush, not just off the neutral zone counter, but getting zone possession on entry. Now watch this play. There's a lot of different elements to this play here. Number one, take a look at Colton Parenko, who you guys know I'm a huge fan of. I think he's going to be an all-star in this league. But him and Jaden Schwartz. Jaden Schwartz has body position behind the net on Thomas Hurdle. Now the thought would be Schwartz would release and go to Joel Thornton. He doesn't. He stays on Hurdle, so this is a read play for Colton Parenko, Scotty. Colton Parenko says, all right, I'm going to leave good ice. I'm going to go now and essentially be a winger, and I'm going to go and try to take out Joel Thornton. Look at the St. Louis Blues, five guys in the picture. That's what every coach wants to see. But take a look at that sea of green, that entire sector. That's a rectangle on the right of the ice. Nobody's there. Joel Thornton, some of the best vision, one of the best players of this generation, future Hall of Famer, first ballot. Watch Joe's vision. He says, okay, I see the play happening behind the net. Hurdle gets a release on Jaden Schwartz, and he's a bigger man. That's a one-on-one matchup, Tone. 55-foot pass is about to come your way. Saucer, airmail. Watch it. There goes Hurdle. 10-2, off Dallin. On his offside, five hole. Beautiful goal. Excellent offensive zone by the Sharks there.
That pass was unbelievable.
You kidding me?
How does that happen?
55-foot sauce.
When you give a good player time and space, he'll burn you. And that's what's going on there. And there's a little bit of a problem there. You had Schwartz and Parenko not sure making a switch. Schwartz was on Thornton to start with. If Schwartz finishes Thornton and stays there, lets Parenko go behind the net to Hurdle, this doesn't happen. But that's what happens. Schwartz starts following the puck. He's young. He's still learning. Now you get two guys on one, and then Parenko has to try to recover and get back to Thornton. And by that time, it's too late. Thornton's made his – he's taken it, surveyed the landscape. He's found Hurdle. What a pass, though, too.
Incredible.
And great hands by Hurdle picking that up.
Yes.
I mean, he had to pick up that puck, which was a laser pass – through Schwartz onto his stick, and he collects it and comes out and makes a great goal. But these are the breakdowns that you can't give the Sharks. They'll make you pay. They're a team that can score in the transition. They don't need a lot. You can't give these guys free offense.
No doubt.
That line has been so good. The word awesome seems inadequate to describe the impact that this group has had. I would say that Hurdle needs to get kicked in the face with a soccer ball before each game, but I don't think that's really the key.
The Sharks might think that too.
It's that they're good. That's really what it comes down to. It is time for the Hat Trick Challenge, presented by Enterprise Weeksy. Playoff level intensity, playoff level pressure. Mm. The first one, Vladimir Tarasenko. Will he score at least one goal in game four?
I'm going to hedge on no, because the St. Louis Blues haven't been playing their game. Although they need Vladimir Tarasenko, 40-goal scorer, to start lighting up the score sheet, he needs some help. He hasn't been himself, but you can make the same case for the Blues so far from an offensive standpoint in this series. This is where the Blues need to play more. Down low, dots down, get that cycle game going. There's not really much available off the rush, and so far Marty Jones has been razor sharp for the San Jose Sharks, so those are the reasons I'm going to hedge no on that one.
How about the captain of the San Jose Sharks, Joe Pavelski? Will he score at least a point?
I'm going to go yes. I mean, that's, come on, that should be money in the bank for UNHL fans out there. Joe Pavelski's played like a man possessed all year long, let alone here in the Stanley Cup playoffs. Good luck shutting down this trio. How about that shot by Hurdle and the pass by Pavelski? And speaking of passes, look at this one. We've never seen a pass like this.
Wow.
Tape to tape, 55 feet, saucer behind the net. Well, that's a pass in any league.
Beauty. So who wins game four?
San Jose Sharks.
No hesitation.
No hesitation. San Jose Sharks win game four. They go up 3-1 in this series. The Sharks are simply playing too complete of a game in all facets of the game. Hurdle has emerged. He's healthy once again. Patrick Marleau playing in a different role than we're accustomed to seeing. He's been outstanding. Brent Burns is a game changer, one of the best in the world at his position. And the Sharks are rolling four. I love what they've done. The back end is more complete. Logan Couture continues to make plays, and The fourth line looks great as well. Did I talk about Marty Jones yet?
No, you should. There's no reason to stop talking about him.
All right, just
good
checking.
Stuff all the way around. Those are Kevin's picks for tomorrow's NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. To score your own hat trick, download the NHL Hat Trick Challenge app or play online at hattrick.nhl.com for your chance to win the $20,000 grand prize or a trip to the Stanley Cup Final. When we return on NHL Tonight, seeing clearly, Tyler Johnson had to love what he was watching. Bolts, Pens, what a game on this Friday night. We're coming right back. Welcome back to NHL Tonight, All Access Quest for the Stanley Cup. The first episode behind the scenes of the conference finals, Saturday, 5:30, right here, Eastern Time, on NHL Network, where you can see awesome stuff like this.
Things change. Time has a way of forcing evolution in all corners of life. And so the way we experience things, the way they look, where they take place, the scenes that surround them. Inevitably, what you see now is different from what others saw then. Or is it? Maybe change alone doesn't best embody the passage of time. For there's also all that endures. Desire. Focus. Fortitude. Passion. Emotions that transcend any given moment. Sensations that can make those moments feel like they can last forever. Yeah! Yeah! There is no other road to a championship in sports as difficult, as exciting, as exhausting as hockey's Stanley Cup playoffs. And there's no odyssey to glory that promises such a beautiful reward at its pinnacle.
It was set in Slapshot, just trying to capture the spirit of the thing. That's what they're doing. New episodes, 9 o'clock Eastern, Friday nights on Showtime through the Stanley Cup Final. That is so awesome. Scotty, it reminds us just how treasured that moment is as a captain hoisting the cup for the first time. Take us back to 95 and what it felt like.
Well, I highly recommend it, Tony.
Yes.
Absolutely. I mean, it's absolutely amazing.
It's so good.
I highly recommend it. If you can do it a few times, even better. But, I mean, it's something that you dream about and you work so hard for 82 games and 2 months of grinding. There's no question it's the hardest trophy to win, and some guys are very unfortunate, don't have the opportunity. So I'm very fortunate to play with a lot of great teammates, guys willing to be disciplined, make sacrifices for the team, accept their roles in winning championships. Like I said, it brings chills. I'm looking up there at the cup here in the rink and look at the names. The guys that are kind of the guys that don't get a lot of print, the Sergei Brelins, the Jay Pandolfos, those types of guys, Bobby Hlick, guys that are so important, Randy McKay. You need all of these guys to win a Stanley Cup. Everyone's important. Everybody has a role. Everybody has a job to do, and you get the job done at the end. It's the most rewarding thing you can do in your hockey career.
No doubt. I think that in Stanley Cup playoffs, on the road to being able to compete for a Stanley Cup, albeit we lost one, everything makes sense. Everything makes sense. Everything that you've worked so hard for, all the workouts, all the training, all the injuries, all the surgeries, they all make sense.
To the Eastern Conference Final, Game 4, the Pens' last cup in 09. Bolts' last cup in 04, their only cup. Game 4, Andrei Vasilevskiy and the Lightning coming out onto the ice. It was a great atmosphere. However, during the pregame warm-up, nightmarish.
Who's the culprit? Who hit him?
Tyler Johnson taking a puck to the face. All kinds of struggles with, do I wear a cage? The visor, it's just a tough situation.
It's like a fashion show, Tony.
Oh.
What do I wear?
The one thing you had no doubt about was that he was going to play because he's a hockey player.
Absolutely.
Darty Bolts in front, 1-0. Under 6 to go in the first. Here comes Tampa. In transition, Kucherov, Schuster, 2-0.
Nice job by Kucherov stalling the engine, slowing it down, gets a puck from Kloren, then here's Schuster joining the play, beating the forecheckers, back down the ice. Good job by Schuster. Nice pass by Kucherov.
Looks like he's content with that mask. Power play. A minute left on the man advantage, 5.5 to play. and Tampa's Jonathan Drouin. Tremendous patience. 3-0.
Incredible patience, the zone entry, so many elements to that goal. Beautiful play and nicely finished.
Nikita Kucherov, so comfortable. And there's Tyler Johnson. Whatever mask you're wearing, you just scored a goal. 4-0.
Well, what a play by Kucherov. Look how he drives a D back and pulls up and then waits for the other forwards to come and makes a beautiful pass across. Kucherov had a wonderful game.
When the Pens won that cup in 09, it was that guy in the cage. Marc-Andre Fleury, Phil Kessel, gets Pittsburgh on the board with a beautiful snipe, Scotty.
Absolutely. Love the way he shoots the puck in stride. Vasilevskiy has the angle but can't stop Kessel.
Evgeny Malkin off the schneid. 8-game goal drought snapped. We got a 2-goal game week, see.
Virtuoso Malkin there. That's exactly what he's capable of doing.
But wait, there's more. Under 7 to go. Pittsburgh power play. Chris Kunitz makes it 4-3.
Great shot pass by Connor Sheary to the front of the net. Schultz tips it. Kunitz finds the open down the rebound.
Final seconds. A scramble. Frantic. But the Bolts and Vasilevskiy and Tampa tie the series at 2 games apiece with a 4-3 game 4 win. The captain of the Penguins, Sidney Crosby, after the loss.
I mean, I don't think it was as horrible as you're trying to make it out to be. I think it was not good. Obviously, they score a first shift, but they're a desperate team. And like I said, it's 1-2-0. We don't find a way to kind of get ourselves back into it with the goal, and they add to the lead. We probably try to take a few chances, and you know that hurt us.
I think, you know, especially heading down to Pittsburgh, 3-1 would not be pretty. So we're happy to pull that one out, and you know, now it's just a 3-game series, and you know, we're hoping that we can go to Pittsburgh and get a win.
Is how disappointed we were after game 3, and have to turn the page. We did that, and I thought we deserved to win that hockey game tonight. Now, in saying that, we have to turn the page as well, because this game, it's over, and now it's a best of 3, and you can't carry this over and say, oh, well, just because we won game 4, we're going to win game 5. Turn the page. Get back what we're doing.
If you look at the pages of the NHL stat book, you'll find just 4 active players averaging better than a point per game active. 3 of them are Penguins. Crosby, Kessel have gotten a lot of attention. Evgeny Malkin, not great attention lately. He had just 1 point in his last 7 games. He delivered during that third period. What does it mean for the Pens to get 71 going? Because that goal was a beauty in the third.
Well, it's huge. I mean, Crosby's starting to find his game. And I mean, the longer this series goes and you let Malkin get going like he is, he's like a train out there controlling the puck, making plays. And you see him here at the middle ice. When he gets to middle ice, he can do things like that. And he finds the opening and beats Vasilevskiy. This guy's a big power forward. And he gets rolling for the Penguins. They could use his help right now in this series being tied 2-2.
They certainly can. He's a game breaker. That's exactly what they need from him. They need Malkin to attack the middle of the ice the way he did there. We talked about it 2 games ago. If you're Malkin with that unique combination of size, skill, and ability, the gifts, play in the middle the way he did there. That was a virtuoso play by Malkin on that goal.
Just between us, forget about the cameras.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there like a secret handshake for Conn Smythe winners? Like when you see Malkin, do you know what I mean? Is there like a secret 2000-year-old night? Just tell us.
Right.
Just us two.
Just between us.
Never met him yet, but it would be fun. I mean, I don't have anything for you. I don't know where it would be.
Can't tell us.
Yeah, exactly. It's undercover.
That's awesome. It's like the Batcave. That's
exactly.
Fun. That's fine.
You
How about the Bridgestone performance of the night?
Us pedestrians.
Ryan Callahan. Scotty, you love the way he started this game.
He set the tone. He set the tone for the Tampa Bay Lightning. He's not a big guy, but he packs a lot of punch to his hits, and he sets the tone for the Tampa Bay Lightning. And he was physical. He was hard in the forecheck. He got to the front of the net, tipped pucks in. For the Tampa Bay Lightning to have success, they got to have Ryan Callahan going.
No doubt. They need that.
Start on time.
Yes, awesome. Which
that
they did.
First shift. He does the pregame interview, yep. Which I'm always like, I don't know that they want to be talking just before the game. Didn't bother him a lick. He
right.
goes out there and he's all over and tips the puck in. What a start.
Great start for him. Great start for them, more importantly. And hey, listen, Tampa, they're the more physical of the two teams.
Yeah.
And that really starts with a guy like Ryan Callahan.
Yeah, and I mean, I thought they were physical against Washington. I thought Washington was a physical team. I thought at the end of that series, the Tampa Bay Lightning were taking it physical. physically to the Washington Capitals, and Ryan Callahan was one of those guys. And when you can skate and get there, that means you can hit, and the Tampa Bay Lightning can skate, so there's no reason why they can't finish checks and be effective and make the Pittsburgh Penguins play defense. This team likes to go on the offense. They want to get out of their zone quick, make them go back into D zone coverage and stop. That's how you beat the Pittsburgh Penguins, and that's what the Tampa Bay Lightning did tonight.
Mm-hmm. We got a series. It's 2-2.
Of course.
Delicious.
Best Bring it.
Three for the right to go to the Cup Final.
Bring
we'll
it.
Take it. And we will also take the opportunity when we return to get more breakdowns. Weeksy and Scotty going in-depth on the Pens next. Welcome back to NHL Tonight. Memorial Cup action at Red Deer earlier on Friday on NHL Tonight. What a spectacle and what a performance. The London Knights already in front 1-0. It's a 4-on-4. And it's beautiful, the way that they execute. Right there, to go up 2-0, Dvorak with the put away.
What motion offensively by the London Knights, clearly mesmerizing the defense of the Red Deer Rebels there.
Moments later, same goal scorer, Christian Dvorak, this time for Mitch Marner.
Look at the vision of Mitch Marner. He knew Dvorak was there before he received the puck right here. He knew, he just turned and put it right on Dvorak's stick, and he put it home.
Trust us, there's more players on the team, but again, it's Marner and Dvorak combining on another goal. This time it's Marner putting it away.
Better contact the Red Deer Fire Department. These guys are on fuego.
It's 5-0. Incredible. Wow. Late in the second, Marner again.
Look at Dvorak finding his buddy over there. And look at Marner. What a laser beam shot over the shoulder. Mitch Marner's got a bright future for the Toronto Maple Leafs.
5 points each. The final score, 6-2 Knights over the Red Deer. Next game, the Memorial Cup. Miranda and Brandon, Saturday, 7 o'clock Eastern, puck drop on NHL Network. Time for the Las Vegas Road Warriors moments.
Crosby has a man in front, Kessel. It's Crosby, a shot, he scores! Crosby, and it's 3-1.
Tremendous puck movement by the Pittsburgh Penguins. They work the puck on the left side to the right side of Andre Vasilevsky, and then all of a sudden, a little interchanging going on. Now they move it onto the left side. Little pitch and catch. Malkin puts it on a tee, and Crosby just blows it over the glove.
Gain the zone for Malkin. Got it across to Crosby. Oh, what a sliding stop made on that half speeder by Vasilevsky.
Looked like he whacked that backhander out of the air, and Vasilevsky made the save of the night so far.
Backhander that you've seen so often from Sidney Crosby. What a reaction, though. Vasilevsky tracking that puck.
Stastny over with a hit on Hurdle. Puck played by Fort. Harrison. Fort down to the right point. Fort jump by Burns. They score! So the Sharks come right back 34 seconds after the St. Louis goal.
Well, we talked about Brent Burns and his ability to get the puck through.
Get the puck deep and he did.
Along this comes now for Killorn. He pulls free. Save score! It slips through. Killorn. And it's 1-0 Tampa Bay.
What a play by Alex Killorn. What a pass by Victor Hedman. A little forehand, backhand, five hole on Matt Murray.
It's notable when you deliver on the road in the playoffs. Keep an eye on Tommy Wingles with the icebreaker. This was game two on a feed from Dinis Zubris. Impressive, giving a Shark lead early in the game. Sharks, of course, this was the first of two consecutive shutouts against the Blues. Significant to be able to take the lead as a road team. These goals stand out. Scotty, I know specifically that Phil Kessel's goal in game three, another road goal, was significant to you. Why?
I mean, it's a huge goal. I mean, it was a big goal for the Penguins. They got their little cycle game going down low against the Tampa Bay Lightning. And here's the video right here. Here's Bonino and Hagelin moving the puck. And right here, you'll watch what happens. There it is. I want to break this down. Philpola has a chance to eliminate Bonino down low here. So here's Kessel. That's a puck goal. And here's this quick cycle game. Bonino lets it go. Hagelin beats his guy, Garrison. Now right here, Philpola has to eliminate Bonino. Bonino cannot make a play. He's got to get him against the wall and finish him. That's how you stop cycles. But he doesn't. He lets Bonino get away. And then you see Strawman leaves the strong side. And there's Kessel. And Bonino makes that pass. But if Philpola is stronger on Bonino there and eliminates him, That stops the cycle game, stops the speed game of the Pittsburgh Penguins, and Bonino cannot make that play out to Kessel. Also, I'd like to see Strawman be within a stick's reach of Kessel there, but that's the point. You got to eliminate people when you get a chance, be physical, take them out of the play, and that was an opportunity there for Philpott to take Bonino out of the play, so he could not make that pass. It was an easy play.
Absolutely. Totally.
Has to be done.
Yep. Excellent execution by the HBK line there. Why not admire more of their work?
Absolutely.
Carl Hagelin now. On this goal, Scotty, what stood out?
Well, Phil Kessel, once again, making a great shot. Phil Kessel is an outstanding player. I mean, over a point a game. Watch him here. So here's good defense. Drouin turns it over. There's Kessel on the back check. We don't see that too often, but he's doing it all. And look at this. He knows where he's going to put this puck right now. And there's Colburn. I want to see Colburn. We always talk about forwards. We say stop in front. I always coach my defense. Stop in front. That's where goals are scored. Where's Colburn going here? You had Hagelin. You're on the D side of him. Keep him on your hip. Look for a rebound. Let Kessel, let Vasilevsky have Kessel there. Colburn had his guy. He left good ice to bad ice. He could have had that rebound on Hagelin.
Totally agree. Goalies, they always say play one shot at a time. For defenders, one man at a time. That's all you got to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I totally agree with you, especially for D-men, because a lot of times, as your point, forwards, they always stop at the net. Goal's going to be scored there. Well, same thing holds true for the D. You can't have a flyby.
Absolutely. You got to stop in front, too. You got to put fires out. And that rebound should have been to Colburn's stick and should have been cleared, but he started going to the other side of the net. I'm not sure if he thought Kessel was going to try the wraparound, but he has to stay in front, haggling with his guy. He had no chance in getting to Kessel. Put the brakes on, stop in front. We always tell forwards, stop in front. You can score goals there. D, you have to stop in front to prevent goals.
Yes.
What a deflating play, too, because it was at the very end of the second period in a scoreless game.
Absolutely.
Heartbreak City. Those were this week's Road Warrior Moments. Presented by Las Vegas, host of the 2016 NHL Awards. Go to NHL.com/Road Warriors to see every Road Warrior moment in its entirety. When we return on NHL Tonight, how about Sidney Crosby mic'd up? Could there be anything better? The answer, no. Come right back. Welcome back to NHL Tonight, Stanley Cup Playoff All Access. Quest for the Stanley Cup. These behind-the-scenes shows premiere each Friday night on Showtime at 9 Eastern. Saturday, see it right here, 5:30 Eastern on NHL Network. Sidney Crosby featured prominently in that, which is fascinating for those of us that have admired his career since he came into the league in 05-06. One thing that comes up again and again is that he's such a polarizing figure. There are those that love the way he plays, and there are those that criticize him so much. From your vantage point, as a Hall of Famer who got a lot of attention during your playing career, what do you think of 87?
I like his game. I like what he brings. And I mean, he's a great offensive player, and I think he gets to the dirty areas. He's got a phenomenal backhand. He's got great speed. That he has that second gear, which I love. Not many guys have the second gear. Connor McDavid has that in Edmonton, and Crosby has that. He's a phenomenal player, a great leader, and he's playing very good hockey right now for the Pittsburgh Penguins.
No doubt. Really, really respects the game, loves the game. Mm-hmm. A historian, every time I speak to him, he always talks about hockey. He's so engrossed in the game, and that says a lot to me because he's a hockey junkie and certainly also very respectful of the process and what it means to be an NHL player, what it means to be a Pittsburgh Penguin, and takes that job seriously. A tireless worker, works like a blue-collar guy on his game, certainly very committed to his craft, and I got to say, this guy is one of the best and will go down as one of the best ever play.
What would a second cup mean for his legacy?
Amazing. Just add more cement to the foundation, Tone.
You know he's going to be near you in Toronto. Those walls, that beautiful vault where the Hall of Famers are, two gold medals and obviously a very decorated career. Winning a second cup. You remember what it was like to win the first in 2000 when you won the Conn Smythe. That second one, how did that feel?
It felt unbelievable. I mean, the first one's always important, but everyone has their ups and downs, and it's just a camaraderie of your teammates and working together, and everyone being important. And to get another one for Sidney Crosby would be outstanding for him and for that franchise.
No doubt. I love it.
Absolutely.
Crosby.
Yes.
Good stuff. 87. We're digging it.
In the warm-up tonight, Tyler Johnson was struck in the face. 1-0 early for Tampa. Drop there. Benetico! Schuster!
snapping your head back, all kinds of that gamesmanship.
Tyler Johnson makes it 4-0.